My name is Mike Benton. I'm at the University of Bristol, and I'm here today to talk about the Bristol dinosaur. Back in 1834, some quarrymen in a quarry in Clifton found some extraordinary bones, and they had no idea what they were. They took them to the museum and showed them to the curator, a man called Samuel Stutchbury, and he thought they came from a crocodile, but he wasn't really sure. So he consulted his friend Henry Riley, and together they studied these bones and urged the workmen to look for more. And then between 1834 and 1836, they found a few hundred isolated bones in the rock. They named this creature in 1836 Thecodontosaurus antiquus, which means the ancient, that's antiquus, sheathed-toothed reptiles, a bit of a mouthful. But they still didn't know what it was because the word dinosaur had not been invented yet. The word dinosaur came about in 1842. When we think of dinosaurs, of course, we think of the monsters like Tyrannosaurus rex and Brachiosaurus. These weighed many tons and they were many tens of meters long. The Bristol dinosaur, of course, is an English dinosaur, so it's a fairly modest-sized creature. It was probably about a meter or 2 meters in length, depending on age. It was a two-legged dinosaur, so it ran about on its hind legs, and probably when it was alive, its body would have been held pretty much horizontal. So the tail, you've got to imagine a long, thin tail sticking out behind, the body more or less horizontal in front, and the neck sort of bent up, and a fairly small head. And indeed, when you look at the head, it's sort of long and thin and pointed. The teeth are just small leaf-shaped things. They're sort of sharp, but not the long, curved, sharp teeth that the meat-eating dinosaurs had. So even the teeth are quite modest, and this is quite probably a fairly inoffensive animal. As far as we know, there are quite a lot of them, so that in the different quarries in Bristol and around Bristol, we found the remains of maybe 20 or 30 individual animals. Presumably males and females. There are two kinds of skeletons. Some of them are a bit more robust than others. Whether those are the males or the females, I don't know. And there are even some juveniles as well. So we have a picture of family life in a way. We're interested in Thecodontosaurus. We work on it in Bristol University because not only is it the Bristol dinosaur, so it has some local interest, but on an international scale it's really important because this is one of the very first plant-eating dinosaurs that ever existed on the earth. Thecodontosaurus would have fed on plants that were around at the time. They were not the typical plants we see today. The kinds of grasses and flowering plants were not there. But presumably it fed on ferns and some kinds of conifers. There were ancestors of monkey puzzle trees around then. It had enemies. There were meat-eating dinosaurs, but we don't have complete skeletons of those. And there were other meat-eaters around at the time. So probably the Bristol dinosaur, Thecodontosaurus, had to be quite secretive. It would have slipped around amongst the trees, a little bit nervous of some of these much larger flesh-eating animals. There's quite an important connection between the Bristol dinosaur and Bristol Zoo. The zoo was founded in 1836 as a result of massive fundraising, and this was led by a local notable called Henry Riley. Riley was the secretary of the Bristol, Clifton and West of England Zoological Society. But in addition to that, he was also a very well-known surgeon. He was sought out by all the fashionable people of Bristol. He taught anatomy to students. He's also infamous for the fact that as part of his teaching, he needed dead bodies. And he was had up in 1828 for body snatching. But that's by the by. At the same time as he was fundraising for the zoo, he was also working with his friend Samuel Stutchbury, who was curator of the museum in Bristol, and who had been given bones of a strange creature from the rocks of Clifton, from a quarry in Clifton. And between them, they wrote about these bones, and they named the animal in 1836, the same year the zoo was founded, as Thecodontosaurus antiquus. If you look at the walls of the zoo, they're made up of a particular kind of rock that actually lies underneath a lot of the upper part of Clifton and under the downs, the area that's sometimes called Durdham Downs. The rock is strange, it's sort of pinkish, but if you look closely, you'll see that there are blocks, irregular blocks of limestone in it. And not many people know that this very strange looking rock actually comes from ancient caves that were formed 200 million years ago. At that time, during the Triassic period, Bristol lay quite near the equator, and so climates were very hot. And the scene we have to imagine was of small islands, limestone islands. And so the Mendip Hills and all the hills around Bristol were actually islands. The sea level was higher. And it was quite a tropical sea. And there were dinosaurs toddling around on these islands. And from time to time, the limestone islands would form into a karst landscape. That means cracks and fissures would form on the surface. Just like you see today in limestone areas. And various animals and soil would wash in and fall down into these caves and fissures, together with broken up bits of limestone. So the red color in the rocks around the walls of the zoo is from the Triassic soil, this 200 million year old soil from the tropical islands. And the pieces of white limestone are the pieces of the cave wall that have kind of fallen in. And then in some of these rocks, and it's worth looking closely as you walk around the zoo, who knows, you might find a dinosaur tooth or some other fragment of a fossil stuck in one of those pieces of stone.